Swayam Prabha. Digital India. Educated India.
Hello, good morning. We'll be talking about pulmonary mycosis today, and basically our aim would be that we would be telling you to identify the common fungi which cause infections of respiratory tract, and also how to identify them and treat them patients because of these infections. Now we'll start with a case history which will help you to understand as to how we diagnose these cases. A patient came who was a gardener. He came with complaints of fever, cough, chest pain, and he was also coughing off blood and having shortness of breath for the last 2 to 3 weeks. On investigations, on further interrogation, he told us that actually to start with, he had stuffiness of nose and he had difficulty in breathing, runny nose and cough which had started along with headache and shortness of breath for over 6 to 8 months. But over the period of time, the cough remained, it did not get improved by anything. There was weight loss, patient also felt fatigued out on little task. And lately, he started coughing blood on out in sputum, and also he started getting fever. Now, on further history taking, we realized that there was no family history of similar episodes or tuberculosis in the family. And on examination, the patient was pale and slender. He had high fever and tachycardia, tachypnea with respiratory distress, and he also had signs of pulmonary consolidation along with pleural rub. CBC count was done and he was found to have neutropenia. Further, X-ray chest and CT scans were done and we found that he had pulmonary nodules along with ground glass opacity, which is also called as halo sign. Sputum was collected, sputum sample. Along with that, we also tried to collect transthoracic CT guided fine needle aspiration from the pulmonary nodules so that we could get very fine sample from the site of infection, and these were sent for microscopy and also for culture. Now, on microscopic examination, we found on KOH stain that there were hyphaecene, septate hyphaecene, fungal hyphae, which could be seen very clearly. Histopathology also showed us a similar kind of thing, that is, there is a dividing hyphae, septate hyphae with acute angle branching was seen under the microscope. Next, we did bacterial culture, but there was no organism grown on bacteria. While Sabrod's agar, that is the fungal medium, there was a greenish blue pigmented growth which was seen, powdery growth in 3 days, and both sputum and CT guided sample both grew the same growth. On lactophenol cotton blue mount of this, we found some these hyphal like structures which had aspergillus, which very similar to looking to aspergillus with sporangia and the spores around them, and this was very typically, and it, the same thing was shown in both the samples. Also, we tried to take a serum sample and we tested it along for galactomannan antigen to see whether the patient was having this antigen in his serum or not, and it was found to be positive. Further, we again repeated the sample from sputum and sputum sample we repeated, because sometimes these spores can be present in the air and you can get false growth. But again, we found the same growth which was got on sputum culture. So, hence the patient was diagnosed as a case of pulmonary aspergillosis. And before investigations had been started, since he was having fever, cough and all, he was started on oral antibiotics, he was given analgesics and fluids, but he had not improved. Later he was changed on to, after the fungal culture grew the fungus, he was changed on to voriconazole, which was started along with steroids, and this was supposed to be taken for the next 6 to 8 months along with steroids being tapered off as and when it was possible. So, like this case, we would like to tell you that there are cases of fungal infections which are coming up. Pneumonia per se is a leading infectious cause of death in developed countries, but fungal pathogens normally rarely cause disease in healthy individuals, but they can cause severe pneumonia in immunocompromised patients, and most respiratory fungi which are diseases are caused by fungi that grow in environment because the spores from there are inhaled and they lead on to this infection. Now, fungi cause, as per se, they cause a small proportion of community acquired as well as nosocomial, that is hospital acquired pneumonias. But there has been a marked increase in the incidence of fungal infections, mainly because of four factors. That is, one is aggressive treatment, which is being given these days, corticosteroids, immunosuppressants, patients of transplants and other diseases which are being treated. Along with there is an increased incidence of population of immunosuppressed patients like AIDS and others, leukemia, lymphoma. Then further, there is greater knowledge of clinical mycology now, better accuracy in diagnosis, and so one can come across these infections more often nowadays than they were found earlier. Also because of increased long span of average life of patients, they are going in for more elderly associated diseases in which they might be more ICU stays, in which cases also these infections are seen to be more common. Now, which are the fungi which can cause these infections? They can be yeast like fungi like Cryptococcus species, dimorphic fungi, Histoplasma, etc., and filamentous fungi like Aspergillus species. Mainly according to the patient risk factor, some of them like patients who have changes in T lymphocytes, their infections like blastomyces, coccidioidosis, Cryptococcus, Histoplasma and pneumocystis would be seen to be causing infection. In neutropenia patients more of Aspergillus and other hyaline hyphae which would be causing infection. So, infection or pneumonia per se in patients could be caused either by endemic or opportunistic fungi. Endemic pathogens are the ones which are seen in healthy individuals or immunocompromised, but they are seen in defined geographic locations of the world, you know, they could be seen in Americas and around the world, like Histoplasma capsulatum, blastomyces, porotrix, Cryptococcus, others. These were earlier seen in certain defined areas called as endemic infections, or they could be opportunistic infections which are normally saprophytic fungi which are there in the environment, and only under special conditions when the patient is immunocompromised or due to some drugs being given the patient is immunocompromised, and then they cause infection. This could also be infections which are patients with who have congenital or acquired defects in immune systems, which are seen by Candida species, Aspergillus species, Mucor species, or there are many hyaline filamentous fungi other than these Aspergillus species also, like Scedosporium, Pestilomyces, all these newer fungi which are seen to be causing infections in these patients because of a lot of immunosuppressants being given. Now, if we talk about epidemiology of fungal pneumonia, one is that it could be endemic because of endemic fungi, like I told you, Histoplasma capsulatum, Blastomyces dermatitis, coccidioidosis, which occur cause infection in certain areas of Americas and other places. Then, or there could be worldwide infections which could be which are more seen in tropical and temperate zones, and these could be due to traumatic inoculation or inhalation like sporotrix species, or they are ubiquitous present in the environment generally and they can cause infection in any of the patients like Cryptococcus infections. Risk factors, many of them like endemic fungi, they are seen to be occurring more in workers or farmers who are with heavy exposure to bird or bat excreta, where you know lot of Histoplasma is seen to be found. Or they could be seen in people who are working in woods and all, where from where they could get the spores of sporotrichosis. Others could be because of patients who are, you know, in near drowning accidents and polluted waters, they could get from natural disasters like Pseudoalchiria and others who've got infections. So these are the different risk factors for the endemic fungi. While otherwise for opportunistic fungi, we can know the risk factors could be either the patient has leukemias, or he is getting transplants, or he is having prolonged corticosteroid therapy, or he is a patient of AIDS or other congenital immunodeficiency diseases, prolonged neutropenia due to any reason or genetic predisposition, all this could lead on to opportunistic fungi infection. As far as transmission is concerned, mostly the fungi are transmitted through inhalation, that is the airborne conidia they are inhaled, or they could in hospitals and all, they could be associated with, you know, building activities. Whenever there is more exposure due to these fungi, or cutaneous also infection could occur because of contaminated biomedical devices. The pathogenesis, basically the fungal spores, they enter into the respiratory tract and there through the bloodstream, and or they could come through the bloodstream or from either a latent infection is getting reactivated. Then they go inside the alveoli where the infection they reach the spaces between the cells in the adjacent alveoli, and they trigger the immune system or neutrophils and all which reach the lungs. They come and engulf these offending organisms, which helps in the release of cytokines and activation of the immune system. This leads on to fever, chills and fatigue, which are due to neutrophils and fluid which is leaked from the surrounding blood vessels. These further neutrophils and fluid which is leaked from there leads on to, which fills the alveoli, can lead on to consolidation and impaired oxygen transportation, and finally leading on to consolidation in the lung. So, the pathogenesis and mainly the prognosis of these cases depends a lot on the severity and outcome of the fungus, immune status of the patient, and whether that immune status of the patient is reversible. That is, if the immunosuppressants can be stopped and the immune status can be got back, then the patient has better chances of recovering. The disease as such, either it could remain in the lungs and go on to get disseminated to different sites, brain, skin, liver or different spaces, or there can be blood vessel invasion, in which case there can be hinoptysis, pulmonary infarction, other infections which can be there, or there can be other complications due to these pulmonary infections of the fungi. As far as diagnosis is concerned, it is difficult to prove. Often it is made on a presumptive basis, because organisms like candida and others, if they are aspergillus and all, if they are isolated once in a while, they could be also isolated from oropharyngeal and respiratory tracts of normal people because of spores being present in the environment. Hence, it becomes necessary to be able to prove that they are coming from the patient, that is, they are not only colonizers, or because of the decreased immune status of the patient, they could be causing infection. Now, so for diagnosing fungal infection, you need to have clinical evidence, you need to isolate the fungus, you need to identify the fungus, that is the microscopically invading the tissue. So, you need to do the histopathological examination. Also, immunological response to the fungus is identified to see that the fungus is causing infection and immune status is coming in play to act against it, or you could also look for molecular markers. Now, they can be, the problems in diagnosis could be either in clinical, that is because there are non-specific symptomatology which could be due to any pulmonary infection, be it bacterial or fungal, one does not know. Then the X-ray signs could be non-characteristic. CT sign also can be non-characteristic, it can be halo to start with, can go on to air crescent formation, so sometimes it is difficult to diagnose. There can be uncharacteristic morphology microscopically, which is not typical of a certain fungus to be identified. Then cultures, even if it gets positive, it could be because of colonization, one cannot be sure that this is the fungus which is causing the disease. Further, the need to prove that a fungus is causing invasion by doing a histopathological examination of the tissue is not sometimes possible, because you can't get a deep tissue sample most of the time. Also, you might have to do antigen assays and PCR to be able to show that the fungus is causing infection. So, that is why it gets very difficult to prove that a fungus is causing fungal pneumonia because of these cases. Now, we will go on to certain individual fungi which can be, which are most often seen to cause fungal pneumonias. Aspergillosis is one of them. Aspergillus infection causes a spectrum of diseases of humans and animals, which is caused by members of genus Aspergillus. It is present in the environment, it grows on dead leaves, organic matter, it is decaying vegetation. Aspergillus fumigatus is the commonest organism which causes infection, but there can be others like Aspergillus flavus, Aspergillus tereus and Aspergillus niger. Now, usually in HIV infection, it is not seen to cause infection, because neutropenia is when the Aspergillus infection is seen. It represents the leading cause of invasive pulmonary infection and lung infection and death, with a mortality rate of 50 to 85%. There is an increased incidence of Aspergillus infection seen in patients with leukemia, chemotherapy or bone marrow transplantation, basically patients who are neutropenic. Mortality is further increased in patients because due to they are immunocompromised, and also because the disease becomes disseminated many times, which can lead on to increased morbidity and mortality. Now, clinical manifestations, it either presents as a pulmonary aspergillosis or disseminated aspergillosis or cutaneous aspergillosis. Pulmonary aspergillosis could be endobronchial saprophytic pulmonary aspergillosis, allergic aspergillosis, or it could be a pneumonia, or could be invasive aspergillosis. To study in detail, now basically pulmonary aspergillosis can range from allergic reaction and colonization to invasive disease. Now, in immunocompetent patients, it will cause a localized infection, and usually this occurs in patients who have an underlying lung disease already being present, allergic bronchopulmonary disease or allergic rhinitis, sinusitis, then they get laden with aspergillus spores. So, there is a colonized localized infection. Or immunosuppressed patients, their invasive pulmonary fungal infection is usually seen with fever, cough and chest pain, and there here the infection can disseminate to other body organs also. So, basically it could be allergic reaction, or it could be a colonization, or there could be an invasive disease, or there could be a disseminated disease of which is seen in aspergillosis. As far as the chronic pulmonary aspergillosis is concerned, which is a long term aspergillus infection due to Aspergillus fumigatus, and this is the species which is most often responsible, it could either be Aspergillus nodule, that is which is seen in most patients who have some lung disease to start with and they develop this infection. They could be having TB or some other disease, ABPA, COPD, which can emphysema, where the fungal spores go and they cause start causing infection. Then, or it could be a aspergillomas, where the ball of fungus gets formed in a cavity which is there, which is already there, and this can either be asymptomatic or it can improve or it can decrease depending on the stage of the patient. Or the patient could have chronic cavitatory pulmonary aspergillosis, and this is, that is, cavities are present and in the lungs, but they are not necessarily with a fungal ball, that is they could be just with aspergilloma or without aspergilloma. Or they could be chronic fibrosing pulmonary aspergillosis, in which the patient is remains, if the remains untreated, we can have chronic scarring of the fibrous tissue of the lung tissue, and there can be lot of fibrosis which can lead on to decreased respiratory efficiency. Symptoms wise, you can also differentiate these. Allergic reaction pulmonary would mainly have symptoms similar to asthma. There will be wheezing, shortness of breath, cough, etc. Sinusitis will have more of stuffiness, runny nose and all, with along with headache, which is there usually present in most sinusitis cases. Aspergilloma usually, so either it remains asymptomatic or can present with cough or coughing up blood in case there is, it invades the blood vessels. There can be shortness of breath. Chronic pulmonary aspergillosis will have the same things along with weight loss, fatigue and hemoptysis being present. Invasive, on the other hand, will present with fever and chest pain, a lot of hemoptysis, and depending on the where the symptomatology is there, how much invasion is there, the patient can be very serious. So, allergic bronchopulmonary aspergillosis or ABPA will mainly have asthma associated. There could be bronchiectasis seen in chest CT scan, and if you test for skin sensitivity of against aspergillus species, it will be positive because this is an allergic reaction. There can be, if you look for serum immunoglobulins, IgE concentration is increased, eosinophilia is there in the patient because he is an allergic reaction. There can be antibodies seen in the blood against the Aspergillus fumigatus, and also on X-ray you will see fleeting infiltrates in the chest cavity. There can be elevated IgE, IgG or to the Aspergillus fumigatus in the blood, and this is the usual course of disease of ABPA. Aspergilloma, on the other hand, basically it starts with fungal spores getting inhaled, and these fungal spores, they settle in a cavity, they go there, they grow free from any interference. Since the immune system cannot, is unable to penetrate into the cavity, this grows, multiplies and they form a ball. So, this is how aspergilloma is formed. Now, this can present as either asymptomatically, I told you, or it can present along with the diseases which were there earlier, TB, psychosis, etc., which were underlying diseases in which the aspergilloma went and developed. Diagnosis sometimes can be difficult because if it does not give a typical symptomatology, it will be difficult to be seen. While on the other hand, invasive aspergillosis occurs most commonly in patients again lungs and sinuses, and there is a setting of neutropenia in many of these cases. They will have fever, cough, chest pain, hemoptysis. And usually they might have some kind of wedge shaped or cavitatory lesions in the lungs which can be seen, and the patient also grows the same, and depending if it is invasive, how much invasion has occurred, it could disseminate to different organs. As far as the risk factors of these patients are concerned, to know them would be useful to prevent these diseases. In ABPA usually they are cases of asthma and all, so if they are treated well, they are taken care of, then many of them can be protected from this disease. Aspergilloma usually would occur in a case which has already got some lung disease, tuberculosis, etc. So, one should be wary and one should be look out for this disease. Chronic pulmonary aspergillosis usually again is associated with other lung diseases, TB, COPD and others. So, these patients need to be investigated accordingly. Invasive aspergillosis will be seen mainly in weakened immune system because of stem transplant, organ transplant, chemotherapy, or patient is on steroids or chemotherapy or for cancer treatment. Those are the patients who will go on mainly to invasive aspergillosis. As far as laboratory diagnosis of these is concerned, so you will take samples which are from the site, that is they could be sputum, bronchial washings, tracheal aspirates, or you could take tissue biopsies depending on the organ system which is involved, or blood sample is taken. And what we try to do is, we try to do direct microscopy, that is 10% KOH, and gram stain smears are prepared. And also tissue sections, if you have, you will stain them with histopath staining like HNE, GMS or silver staining or PAR staining. And you could see hyphae like these, which are acute angle branching, and they are septate hyphae which are seen, which are, this is a very typical picture which is seen, appearance of septate hyphae with acute angle branching. But definitive diagnosis is difficult sometimes, because this sensitivity of microscopic positivity is very low, and also similar microscopic appearance might be there because of other filamentous fungi. Now, histopathologically you could see like these, you know, the sulfur crested cockatoo appearance of Aspergillus fumigatus, or you could see a vesicle like this in HENE. On silver staining you see these black stained hyphal structures. You can grow them on culture, they are easy to grow. On sabrodextrozega, the colonies are fast growing, they may be white, yellow or brown or green depending on the species which is being isolated. Drawbacks is that it is rarely relatively insensitive, and invasive aspergillosis, you might have a false negative, that is you might not be able to grow the fungus. Repeated isolation of Aspergillus from sputum and others, and fresh, and you know, from samples which are from the site of the infection, say a bronchoalveolar lavage sample, could indicate endobronchial colonization of infection, and the culture appears something like this, powdery granular growth of different colors depending on the species, and on microscopy it looks like this. The fungus has a typical appearance. Sometimes it is difficult that you are not getting by microscopy or by culture positivity, then in that case serology can help us a lot. That is, you look for antigen. Galactomannan antigen detection especially has got an important role in early diagnosis of invasive aspergillosis. It detects a polysaccharide of the cell wall of the fungus, and basically it is a Platelia lab assay which is FDA approved. It can be done in serum and bile sample, and it detects antigen. It is a very sensitive test, but there can be false positive test with the certain other antibiotics the patient is taking, or it could have cross reactivity with other fungi, which should be kept in mind. But otherwise it is a very good test to be able to detect that a fungus is causing infection. Even when the culture is negative, it can help you. Beta D glucan assay is another test which is used for diagnosis of these cases. This also detects a portion component of cell wall of Aspergillus species and all other fungi also. This is also FDA approved fungitail assay. Specificity is reduced in the presence of usage of certain antibiotics in patients with other infections, but mostly these antigen detection is very important, and they can help you in diagnosis of invasive infections. Or if still one cannot do, one can look, try and do molecular assays, that is PCR, for detection of Aspergillus species from clinical samples. Tissue samples and bowel is being done, but this is being standardized by many labs and it is not being universally used. As far as these patients are concerned, there should be to reduce or to prevent infection of Aspergillus, prophylaxis is recommended during prolonged neutropenia of these patients, whoever are at high risk for aspergillosis. They could be stem transplant, organ transplants, solid organ transplant, lung transplant. Prophylaxis is indicated, especially in these patients have neutropenia. Treatment, most cases do not require treatment, or treatment sometimes requires treatment of the associated diseases such as tuberculosis and others which are associated. Single aspergilloma per se can be removed with surgery and are best given pre and post operative antifungal drugs. Hemoptysis, if it is there, the angiography and carbolization needs to be done along with surgery. Severe hemoptysis or with empyema or in pneumothorax and all, one needs to remove the aspergilloma, lobectomy might be required, and also resection to prevent bleeding. Or interest, finally, basically one has to do treatment with itraconazole, which is not reliable sometimes, so one has to go on to other drugs. As far as management of invasive pulmonary aspergillosis is concerned, primary treatment is given voriconazole, and if not, if it is not helping out, one tries liposomal amphotericin B. Salvage therapy can be done with echinocandins or posaconazole. Further continuation is done with voriconazole or itraconazole. As far as chronic cavitary pulmonary aspergillosis is concerned, itraconazole and voriconazole are the first line treatment, first and second line treatments. In case patient is intolerant or develops hypersensitivity, one can try posaconazole. But then one has to monitor the blood levels of antifungals and also monitor with regular chest x-rays, serological markers and other, to monitor the progression or the cessation of the disease. So, this was as far as Aspergillus infection was concerned. Now, we will go on to other infections which are emerging mycoses which are causing these pulmonary infections. They could be histoplasmosis by Histoplasma capsulatum, blastomycosis, penicillosis, zygomycosis or non-albicans candida which are seen these days to cause these infections. Now, histoplasmosis, it is an asymptomatic or relatively mild self-limiting pulmonary infection it causes usually. Chronic or acute disseminated diseases can also occur. Fever, cough, weight loss, hepatosplenomegaly and nephropathy are the common clinical features. It is an intracellular parasite and it goes and stays within reticuloendothelial system. These histoplasma, they are found in soil enriched with droppings of birds and bats from where the infection arises, and severity of the illness depends on the host immunity and also the intensity of the exposure. Cause is Histoplasma capsulatum, and mostly it is the infection is caused through inhalation. A pulmonary infection is the primary lung infection, 95% of cases it could be either as inapparent or it could be subclinical or it could be a benign infection to start with. Extrapulmonary infection is the reticuloendothelial system involvement. So, the patient could present with lymphadenopathy, fever, anemia and there could be increased fatality. Skin and mucosa can also be involved, there can be granulomatous and ulcerative lesions, or it could be a disseminated disease like and may mimic miliary tuberculosis. Pulmonary histoplasmosis per se can either be acute, subacute or chronic. And it presents with diffuse interstitial or nodular infiltrates. Patient can have fever, sweat and weight loss. There can be hilar or mediastinal and focal patchy infiltrates which can be seen, or there could be calcification and in chronic cases consolidation which is seen, and they along with some cavitary lesions. As far as the fungus is concerned, basically it comes from the environment. The fungus grows in the environment and the spores, they are inhaled. They go and they circulate in the air and they are inhaled and they go into the enter the lungs. Here the fungus depend on because of the warmer temperature in the host gets converted into a yeast like form. These yeast like form divide and they further travel to lymph nodes, and from there they can go on to different blood vessels to different parts of the body and cause disseminated infection. As far as sequelae is concerned, since because of dissemination first to start with it could have pulmonary nodules, it can go on to mediastinitis, mediastinal granuloma, fibrosis, or it could go on to chronic disseminated disease and finally a high fatality or mortality in patients who are immunocompromised, especially HIV infected patients. To diagnose these cases, one needs to get samples from the right side, that is if it is a pulmonary infection, we need sputum and bronchial washings, pleural fluid, blood sample, bone marrow if it is bone marrow is involved because it is a reticuloendothelial cell infiltration is caused by these. Tissue biopsies wherever the infection is suspected from any visceral organ, and we do a microscopic examination, that is we try to detect the yeast cell in tissues or respiratory samples because in the it is a dimorphic fungus. So, it is like a yeast in the human tissue or at 37 degrees centigrade. So, you will see yeast forms here in the macrophages. Here in the you can see yeast forms are there in the cells. This is what is seen in the human tissue, which can be done by any of these histopath stainings. So, histopathology is one of the most important tests for diagnosis. You can also grow them, you can culture them, since it is thermally dimorphic at 37 degrees centigrade, it is a yeast form, at room temperature 25 degrees centigrade, it is a mold form. And this when it is seen on lactophenol or microscopically, it appears like this in the room temperature. While in the host phase, it is the yeast form or at 37 degrees centigrade, it is seen in the yeast form. So, it can grow at the room temperature as a white cottony mycelial growth with thick walled spores and tuberculate spores which can be seen. This may take up to 6 weeks to grow, become positive and most useful in diagnosis severe histoplasmosis. Further diagnosis is done by serology, that is you can do antigen detection by enzyme immunoassay which can be done from urine, serum or bowel sample or CSF sample, whichever sample you feel is ideal depending on the organ system being involved. And antigen detection is very helpful for early diagnosis and sensitivity is high, especially in patients who are immunocompromised. You could also detect antibody, but usually this is not so efficient. It is difficult because antibodies take 2 to 6 weeks to develop. Further, if a patient is immunosuppressed, the antibody detection might be difficult. This antibody can be detected by immunodeficient methods, or you can do complement fixation test to detect these antibodies. Also, you can do a delayed hypersensitivity test, skin histoplasmin skin antibody test in case of patients who are not responding by any other method, you can try to detect by this method also. Treatment of histoplasmosis, for some people the symptoms will go away without treatment. That is, mild to moderate cases of acute pulmonary might be asymptomatic and they might get okay on their own. Depending on the severity of infection, the patient's immune status, one has to decide whether the treatment has to be given and for how long. Now, prescription of antifungal medication is especially needed for severe histoplasmosis, chronic diseases, disseminated diseases and where CNS is involved. And antifungal agents are the ones which are needed. Amphotericin B, including liposomal or lipid formulations, or you could give itraconazole for mild to moderate infection and as a step down therapy. Blastomycosis is another disease which can cause pulmonary infection, which is seen as pulmonary blastomycosis caused by Blastomyces dermatitis. Few case reports have been there from India earlier, but now we are seeing more infections, more commonly seen in HIV positive patients. And there are different two species, but dermatitis and Gilchrist. Commonly causes self-limited and localized pulmonary lesions, but they can cause a chronic progressive disseminated diseases also in a immunocompromised patient. They can cause suppurative and granulomatous lesions in lungs and other tissues, which could be skin or bone. Habitat, the fungus lives in the environment, particularly in moist soil or decomposing matter. Mainly it used to be seen earlier in United States and Canada surrounding the Ohio and Mississippi river valleys, but now it has been seen in other places also. In India also we have been detecting blastomyces more often now. People who participate in outdoor activities and expose themselves to wooded areas are the ones who are at higher risk for getting blastomycosis. Mode of infection is by inhalation, it enters the lungs, it could be asymptomatic or go on to focal or diffuse consolidation. Or cutaneously it could enter, there could be a papule to start with going on to nodule formation and a ulcer formation. So, the fungus, it is there in the air, lives in the environment as a mold, it produces fungal spores which are inhaled, they go into the lung cavities and there because of the higher temperature or the optimum temperature they germinate and form yeast forms. These yeast stay in lungs, they can spread through the bloodstream, go to the different organ systems and cause disseminated disease. Asymptomatic infection is seen in 50% cases. Symptomatic infection would present in 3 weeks to 3 months after exposure. Non-specific febrile illnesses are seen, that is fever, cough, night sweats, myalgias, arthralgias could be seen, or there could be acute or chronic pulmonary disease mimicking tuberculosis or chronic or community acquired pneumonia. Disseminated disease can occur depending on which organ system is involved, cutaneous, genitourinary or bony lesions. And people who have weakened immune systems may have very severe blastomycosis and than people who are otherwise healthy. So, it could present in acute or chronic as an acute or chronic pulmonary disease, which could mimic an pneumonia, have retronodular infiltrates on X-ray chest, and this can progress to respiratory distress syndrome like in seen in AIDS patients. Or it could be a cutaneous form which is seen in 40 to 80% cases. This is also a marker for multi-organ involvement. There could be different lesions, I told you papules, ulcerative nodules, or there could be abscesses. Skeletal, it could be involving longer bones or vertebrae and ribs, and typically a well circumscribed osteolytic lesion is what is seen, starting as a soft tissue abscess and going on to further infections. 10 to 30% of cases in men and women are also seen to have genitourinary involvement, mainly involvement of the prostate and epididymis. For lab diagnosis, we will collect samples from the site of infection in pulmonary from sputum, bowel, lung biopsy if possible, skin biopsy wherever required if there are skin lesions, and you try and do a KOH or chalcofluoride microscopy, or you do histopath staining by PAS, GMS or Gram stain. Microscopy is especially important for yeast. You will see in respiratory samples, you will see these thick walled yeast samples which have got a broad base bud. You could be seen by histopath staining in the host tissue. While if you grow the fungus, it will grow something like this, which will have mycelial form, which is seen in the microscopy from the culture. Culture is confirmatory, it is gold standard for diagnosing, but it is not so easy. Commercially available DNA probe can be used to confirm this fungus. You can also do fluorescent stain direct for the histopathological demonstration of this fungus in the host tissue, like this is seen in the host. Further, you could detect antigen in urine, serum or bile by ELISA test, but cross reactions are possible with histoplasma and other fungal diseases. Antibody detection can be done by immunodeficient complement fixation, but the sensitivity and specificity is less, especially in patients who are immunocompromised. You can also detect by PCR the organism in clinical samples, but it is still experimental, but it is promising. Treatment of blastomycosis, most people will need treatment with antifungal medication. Itraconazole is a type of antifungal which is typically used to treat mild to moderate blastomycosis and also as a step down therapy. Amphotericin B is usually recommended for moderate to severe blastomycosis in lungs or other infections, especially CNS and others. Depending on severity of infection and patient's immune status, infection treatment can be given from 6 months to 1 year, depending on what is the state of the patient, how severe the infection is there. Pneumocystinosis is another infection which is being recently seen, but this is being seen mostly in immunocompromised patients. This is not a pathogen in healthy humans. In people with weak immune system, it can cause pneumocystis, pneumonia, PCP which is called, and in some cases it can have an extra pulmonary spread. Now, this is PCP is the commonest presentation of pneumocystis gyrovesi infection and is the leading cause of mortality in these immunocompromised patients. Especially patients who have CD4 counts less than 200 microliter are the ones who are likely to develop PCP. Traditionally considered to be an intracellular protozoan, recently it has been classified as a fungus. It exists in two forms, trophozoites and cyst form. Now, trophozoites, these are the trophozoites which can be seen in a bowel sample. Now, what happens is the cycle, it goes on in the lungs, it forms trophozoites, there are different organism which is inhaled, it goes in and forms a precystic stage, then further early cysts are formed, maturation, and then further divides and it goes on to form trophozoites and cyst, and this cycle goes on within the respiratory tract of the patient or in the pulmonary mucosa. Clinically, the patient presents with fever, mild and dry cough, dyspnea, cyanosis can present, and lot of sputum production. But the typical thing is that in patients infected with HIV, the disease course tends to have a more subtle presentation in symptomatology compared to the signs. The signs might be very severe, but the patient will have very, you know, subtle presentation of symptomatology. He might be having respiratory failure, but he will not look so serious. On chest X-ray, you can see diffuse alveolar or interstitial pulmonary infiltrates which can be seen. And for diagnosis, one needs to take a respiratory sample, especially induced sputum. Using 3% hypertonic saline, you can take a bowel sample, which is an ideal sample, or you could take a bronchial or lung biopsy and do direct microscopy by staining with GIMSA staining, GMS staining, toluidine blue O staining, or you could use direct fluorescent antibody test, which is a very sensitive and specific test to pick up these organisms. They could be either seen in the cyst form or in the trophozoite form. Definitive diagnosis PCP is mainly by demonstration of P. gyrovesi in the suspected sample. It could look like these, the cyst in toluidine blue O stain, or direct immunofluorescence, you could see, you know, cysts and trophozoites in this typical honeycomb appearance. GMS staining, they could have these cup and saucer shaped black stained cysts which are seen. You could see in GIMSA stain, toluidine blue stain, and this organism mainly needs to be demonstrated by microscopy as it cannot be grown on culture. And mainly it is seen more in immunocompromised patients and seen recently. Other infections which are causing pulmonary infection are zygomycetes. They are causing zygomycosis. They are primitive, fast growing, largely saprophytic fungi. They are present in the environment. Infection is acquired from nature with no person to person spread. And co-infection with zygomycosis in HIV is rare. It is not so common. But when the CD4 counts are very low and in presence of neutropenia, it could cause infection. Most infections are seen in patients with diabetes mellitus or with severe debilitating disease like leukemia, lymphoma, especially the rhinocerebral form. It has also been seen with iron therapy, more patients associated with iron therapy. Its increased incidence in patients with hematological malignancies has further, you know, complicated the needed the treatment by newer azoles which is needed on this front, because otherwise it is difficult to treat this infection. Now, clinically, it could present as a rhinocerebral form or a pulmonary zygomycosis. gastrointestinal form, cutaneous form or a disseminated form. This is a very severe infection, it spreads very fast. Mucormycosis is the second most common of cause of fungal pneumonia. Approximately 10% of all invasive pulmonary infections are caused by mucormycosis in immunosuppressed patients, and they have a significant morbidity and mortality. Mostly they are caused by rhizopus, mucor, absidia, rhizomucor species, but newer fungi like Apophysimus, Physocymisis and Cunninghamella species are being seen more often to be causing diseases these days. Transmission of spores is from environment, it could be by inhalation, inoculation or by ingestion. Most cases are sporadic cases, or they could be healthcare associated outbreaks linked to adhesive bandages, wooden trunk depressors, hospital linens or building constructions. They can be community associated outbreaks, especially associated with trauma or during natural disasters. So, pulmonary mucormycosis generally occurs in patients who have hematological malignancies or profound neutropenia. They clinically, they will present with non-specific symptomatology of fever and cough, chest pain and dyspnea. But if they are angioinvasive, they very rapidly can spread through the blood vessels, go on to cause tissue necrosis and cavitation and or hemoptysis. For diagnosis, we need to get the samples from the site of infection, the skin scraping in cutaneous, sputum and others in cases of nasal discharges or aspirates, biopsy tissue of the organ system which is involved, and you do a microscopy by using 10% KOH, or you could stain the tissue sections with histopath stains like HNE and GMS. So, definitive diagnosis is by direct demonstration of this fungus in the tissue, that is most important, and by culture. So, they will look like aseptate, ribbon like broad thin walled hyphae, which have got right angle branching, which is a very significant feature to be able to diagnose, differentiate it from Aspergillus infection. If you see a picture like this in microscopy, you can straight away think of mucormycosis and inform the clinician, because this infection can spread very fast since it is angioinvasive and can lead to a lot of morbidity. You can grow the fungus on tablet dextrozegar, it grows very fast, white to gray brownish colonies could be got within a day, 1 or 2 days. But being common contaminants and present in the air, culture from non-sterile samples like sputum and all should be interpreted with caution, unless there is a presence of underlying lesion or a patient has got profound immunosuppression, or one should try and take repeated samples and try and demonstrate the fungus. Mucor species are either, they would have a typical growth like this, they have a sporangium which is full of spores, and these spores are spread out, they can spread in the air by and they are taken in by inhalation. Different risk groups are there for mucormycosis. Most important is uncontrolled diabetes, malignancy, they can be stem cell implant, transplantation, which could be more prone to them. Whenever there is persistent neutropenia, prolonged corticosteroid therapy, skin traumas, burns, surgical wounds, when there is iron overload, IV drug uses, malnourished patients, premature infants, all these act as different risk factors for the mucormycosis. Treatment. Early recognition, diagnosis and prompt administration of appropriate antifungal are important for improving outcome of these patients, because these patients can get very serious and very fast they can get because of the angioinvasive nature of the fungus. Amphotericin B, posaconazole and isavuconazole are active against most mucormycetes. Lipid formulation of amphotericin B are often used as first line treatment. In addition, surgical debridement or resection of infected tissue should be done. Particularly for rhinocerebral, cutaneous and gastrointestinal infections, control of the underlying immunocompromised condition of the patient, and also patient might need treatments like hyperbaric oxygen therapy and all as symptomatic supportive treatment in certain situations. Prognosis is bad, usually it depends on whether several factors, rapidity of diagnosis and treatment, site of infection, patient's underlying condition and degree of immunosuppression of the patient. But still the overall mortality rate is approximately 50%, although early identification treatment can lead to better outcomes. That is why it is very important to be aware of these fungi and to look for them and to know ways of how to diagnose them. P. boidi, Apiospermum, these species are the ones which are emerging pathogens in the same in the immunocompromised host as aspergillosis. They can cause pneumonia, they can cause disseminated infection. Scedosporium species, especially the prolificus, are inherently resistant to amphotericin B and echinocandins. So, it becomes all the more important because these organs, these fungi will not respond to them. So, if you try and detect them, identify them, only then you can tell the clinician not to give these antibiotics. High mortality rates are seen, especially in profound, persistently profound neutropenia. Mortality rate can be for untreated histoplasmosis and others could be up to 80%, but can be reduced to less than 25% if they are promptly diagnosed and treated. Especially these patients, Scidosporium, Pseudoelseria boidi and all, which are now recently being found in these patients. So, if you are on the lookout for them, only then you try and look for them, you will diagnose them and promptly inform the clinician, which is a must, which is important for management of these patients. Candida species, earlier it never used to be considered a pathogen for pulmonary cases, but increasingly because it is a present as a commensal in oral cavity and GI tract, but amongst their pathogenic yeast, Candida albicans and Glabrata are the ones which are the ones which have been seen to cause infections very often, but still not considered causes of pneumonia. Pneumonia from these cases is non-neutropenic patients, it is exceptional, but in immunocompromised patients, these might cause pneumonias. Primary pneumonia and pulmonary lesions, they could either present as primary pneumonia or it could present as pulmonary lesions. Primary pneumonia could occur from an aspiration event or from hematogenous dissemination. Pulmonary lesions could occur by benign colonization or contamination of the oropharynx by airways. So, usually these could be there, that is small lesions which are there due to contamination colonization, but they need not go on to primary pneumonia, that is consolidation. So, identification of the yeast form cultured sample is important, but it is still unreliable because one cannot be sure that they are causing infection. Histopathological evidence of pulmonary invasion is a must to be able to say definitive diagnosis. So, to be able to say that organisms, commensal organism like Candida is causing infection, a histopathological evidence of fungal invasion is a must. Otherwise, just isolation or showing them in microscopy is not what is going to help you for diagnosis because they could be present in normal samples also. So, a demonstration of fungi, the Candida, pseudo hyphae and the yeast in the fungal tissue is what is finally going to be able to tell you for sure that it is causing infections. So, they are not so, and they are not so commonly seen also as causing infection. So, finally, I would try to end this lecture by saying that these organisms which are earlier not considered to be causes of pulmonary infections are now increasingly being found, but they should be seen with suspicion. Clinical suspicion should be there. Early diagnosis and treatment is what is needed to reduce the morbidity and mortality of these cases. Thank you.